Ago.
Amen.
Ago.
Amen.
Ago.
Amen.
We'd like to humbly welcome you all to our illustrious Institute of African Studies. And as you know, you are here for the Black History Month and Beyond program. Now many ask, how come we have to have the shortest month for the people with the longest history? But we said we're going to break through the end of February into March, to the rest of the year, to the rest of our lifetimes. So today, we are very pleased to have a very black powerful, blacknificent, black-orific, black-tastic, black-spiring, black man, who is the AU deputy chair. As some people say, he is the vice president of all of Africa. I've gotten the chance to hear him talk before, and even though he's been serving the people in the government, various positions, he will put all of us scholars out of work because he is a true scholar. So never, ever, ever think otherwise. And he will show you exactly what he can do very shortly. So with no further ado, I'll pass it over to our chair, who is also illustrious, praiseworthy, blacknificent. This is Professor Joji Chikata. And if you can all give her a round of applause, and I'll turn it over to her.
What to say, except to add my words of warm welcome. Welcome to the Institute of African Studies, to the fourth day of our Black History Month celebration. And I think my duty here is to introduce our speaker. And I asked Obadele to send me his CV. He didn't, then it struck me that actually, why am I looking for his CV? Because I've known him since I was a teenager. So this introduction is from my own perspective, so forgive me if it's rather personal. As Oba has said, he's Ambassador Kwesi Quartey, and he's the incoming deputy chair of the AU. And I've known him since the 70s when he was a law student at the University of Ghana. And the reason I got to know him was that I was a student in a nearby secondary school. And he and his friend Bauer took the initiative to come and give us some lectures for what we call general paper in those days. We used to have a subject called general paper. And it was really about current affairs. And I think, I don't know why they decided to do this. I have my own guess about this. But he and his colleague gave us several talks on issues of the Pan-African experience of colonization and the post-colonial era. Also the challenges of underdevelopment. Some of my most vivid memories of these lectures were the discussions on apartheid. In those days, it was a raging topic in Africa, and we're all galvanized into a continent-wide anti-apartheid movement. And he and his friend talked to us about this. And I think that's when my political sensibilities and my postures were born. So I'm truly grateful to him for that foundation on which I have built. After his studies at the University of Ghana, he joined the Foreign Service, and in a career spanning 35 years, he served Ghana in Cotonou, Cairo, Brussels, Havana, London, and New York. His last posting was to Addis Ababa as Ghana's ambassador. He was very well liked for his simplicity and approachability, as well as his commitment to the cause of Africa. Now, how do I know this? It happens that because of my work, I go to Addis a lot to work with the UNECA, and several times, many friends spoke to me about him with great respect and affection. And although I'm no nationalist, I used to feel honored that I could count him among my friends. And this was such an important person, and yet he had retained what we all liked about him, this approachability and simplicity. And basically, it was no surprise to me that he was such a popular choice for deputy African Union chair. He polled 44 out of 54 votes of the heads of state. On retiring from the Foreign Service, he also served as Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs under the Mahama government, and he was also appointed secretary to former President Mahama. One noticeable thing about Ambassador Quartey was actually his progressive Pan-Africanist postures. And they were evident to me even as a teenager. And in the years I've known him since, he has been very consistent in his support for the Pan-African movement and to many progressive causes. While his diplomatic career has been incompatible with frontline political activity and activism, he remained connected and supportive of many of our movements. But the one thing which always amazed me was his research into slavery and his interest, long-standing interest in intellectual work into slavery. And I always wondered how he found the time for all these diplomatic duties to do this. So I'm really glad that today we'll have the opportunity to engage with him on this subject. But my last word is to say to him again, and I've already said this, how pleased and energized I was by his election as deputy chair. As I told him then, at this time in our lives, we often do not get good news. The news is bad, and there are many senses in which the news is bad. But I thought that to have somebody like him with his politics in that role is a blessing, and I know he'll continue to consistently champion the cause of the Pan-African movement and also the people of Africa everywhere. So this is your speaker, Ambassador Quartey. You have the floor.
Ladies and gentlemen,
brothers and sisters, fellow Africans and friends of Africa, I was encountered by our chair for this afternoon when she was a very curious and teenager in Ashburnham School, my old school. I had come to Legon to look through a bookshop. No, actually, I was working in a foreign ministry. I come to Legon to look through the bookshop, and I met a former head teacher of ours, Mr. Boafor, who told me, "Are you old boys? You should come and help us in Ashburnham." I said, "What can I do for you?" So I said, "Oh, we have a shortage of teachers to come and help us in our general paper and class." So upon that, I called a friend of mine. We were all in our very revolutionary years, hoping to make a revolution and overthrow apartheid and bring peace and justice and all that. So I was happy to undertake that task. And in doing that particular job, every Friday around 1 o'clock, we drive to Ashburnham to have a 1.5 hour lecture with them. They were a very interesting young class, and within that class was the daughter of Kwame Nkrumah and then a few others who have gone on to do very great things now, as you see. My sister here is now a professor, a whole professor. So we have been mixing the great and the good. And I'm very grateful for the opportunity to come and interact with you here on a subject that is getting more and more interesting. It will simply not go away. The links between the transatlantic slave trade, the whole movement towards emancipation, the coincidence of all that with Ghana's independence, the move towards unity and integration of the African continent, and the way forward for the African, the black person, whether black lives do matter or not. So we're going to examine those issues. And I have to apologize if this lecture is a little long. I know that one cannot inflict a talk of more than 30 minutes on people within the university. So excuse me if it should get boring, just let me and I'll see that. I've spent my time in the civil service because that was the easiest job to get to after investing in a time. But I've not regretted joining the civil service and joining the foreign service because that afforded me the opportunity to travel a little and see a bit of the world. And in some of the travels, something strike you as very interesting. I recall arriving in the Muro Castle in Havana, and there was an uncanny resemblance or relation to Cape Coast Castle and Yadina Castle that I view here in Accra, in Ghana. And it took a while before it struck me that conceptually, Elmina and Cape Coast were the point of embarkation. And that what I saw in Muro Castle and also in Jamaica, they had a structure which was destroyed by a great earthquake sometime in the 30s. But the remains are there, and the families who live there. There was something uncanny about it. Together, they form a conceptual whole. Elmina and Cape Coast being the point of disembarkation, Muro and Jamaica, the rest being the point of, Elmina and Co being the point of embarkation, Muro and Co being the point of disembarkation. And altogether, they form a conceptual whole, which in my view, tells the story of the African. Now, there was a time here, we had the visit of a Governor General of Canada who used to be a journalist in Haiti, grew up in Haiti, became a journalist in Canada, Madame Mikaël Jean, who has now become the chairperson of the Francophonie. Now, she paid a visit here to Ghana at a certain point, and in drafting the speech for President before then, the task which fell on me, I put in a point about our sister coming from slave ancestry, having broken the bonds, become educated, became Governor General of Canada, and the coincidence of her coming back to Ghana as Governor General of Canada. And the fact that our president then, President Kufuor, in his speech, I put in something about the slave trade, but the speech writers converted it. And the President Kufuor ended up apologizing to Madame Kaijian for the slave trade that we Africans undertook, which apology, of course, the Governor General graciously accepted. And that was not dissimilar to the one experience that we had with Prime Minister Tony Blair. Again, with President Kufuor, Tony Blair came here and paid a visit to Elmina and Cape Coast Castle to get acquainted with the links between Britain and Ghana, and it was getting the 200th anniversary of the abolition of slave trade, so he couldn't really avoid that topic. So President Kufuor again apologized to Prime Minister Tony Blair that we Africans sold our brothers and sisters, and we are very sorry for it. Tony Blair again graciously accepted our apology. He said, I've been thinking. I noticed that our friends in the Caribbean got really upset by that apology, and there was a lot of not so kind remarks written all over it about Ghana and Ghana's betrayal of the black people by apologizing for slavery. So that's got me interested, so I started to read a little more on this subject. And in reading about it, all kinds of interesting things came up. I then went on and looked up a book by a German anthropologist, Dr. De Bruyne, who wrote about Christianity in Ghana, history of Christianity in Ghana. And he began the book by this. He said that Don Diego da Zambia, that was a leader of the Portuguese expedition, landed in Elmina on 20th January 1482, with all his people smartly dressed, but with hidden arms in case of need. Now, he said, on a small hill stood a big tree, and on this tree, the Royal Portuguese banner was hoisted. At the foot, an altar was set up, at which the first mass in this part of Africa was said. The mass was heard by the Amen, that is the Portuguese describing the event, with many tears of devotion and thanks to God for allowing them to praise and glorify Him in the midst of these idolaters, that is the Gukus Africans. And ask God to give them wisdom and faith to draw these idolatrous people to the faith, so that the church they will find might endure until the end of the world. Then the local chief, the Cocos chief, the Ghanaian African chief, whose real name was Chief Kwame Ansa, but because the Portuguese couldn't quite get the accent, they called him Caramansa. He was to respond to what the Portuguese leader had said. So the Portuguese leader had also sought to win the soul of Kwame Ansa to Christianity. So what Chief Kwame Ansa said was interesting. He said, as politely as he could, he tried to suggest the Portuguese that they were welcome to come and trade, but he did not quite like them building a castle as they hoped to build there. Because friends who meet occasionally remain better friends than if they were neighbors. And that with peace between them, his people might even be ready to hear more of the God that they were talking about. There's always been a heated debate about the part Africa played in the slave trade. For a long time, the slave traders took refuge before what they saw as the irrefutable argument that Africans made it a regular practice of stealing their fellow Africans, and that if the Europeans refused to buy the slaves from them, other people, meaning Arabs and the rest, who also used black slaves, would do so. And that slavery did exist in Africa, which we don't deny. But there's been an argument generally that this slavery literally brought civilization to Africa. We spent a long time trying to refute some of these, but among those whose research has had an impact on this is former Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago, Professor Dr. Eric Williams. In his research, he found out that according to the British records, the Negro slaves were regarded as extremely valuable. He quoted the book of records by one Renatus Emmis, who was writing in 1663, who said that the Negro slaves were described as the strength and sinews of the Western world, and that the preservation, improvement, and development of the trade to Africa was a matter of high importance to the kingdom, and that the first English slave training expedition to West Africa was by Sir John Hawkins in 1562. And when Queen Elizabeth I heard about it, she was a little upset and was hoping that the Negroes would not be carried away without their consent. Now, later in my research on this, I also discovered a book written in 1751 by an English political economist called Postlethwaite. The book was entitled Great Britain's Commercial Interests, where he described the slave trade as the principal foundation, the mainspring of all the wealth which sets the wheels of industry in motion. So I began to wonder a little more. So as I continued to research the picture became clearer. Slave ships sailed from Liverpool with a cargo of manufactured goods, guns, padlocks, handcuffs, were exchanged on the coast of Africa with Negro slaves who were transported to the United States, America, and the Caribbean, produced sugar, cotton, molasses, which are then retransported to Europe, and so on. So actually, the roots of globalization, the beginnings of international trade as we know it, began with the transatlantic slave trade. The only difference was that the commodities were our ancestors. The commodities were Negroes. And in the British records, they described the Negroes as the fundamental prop and support of the colonies. They were referred to as a magnificent superstructure of American commerce and labor power on an African foundation. So involved was the British economy in all this that sometimes their publications revealed more than they probably would have wanted to reveal with the benefit of hindsight. A publication in 1764 described Governor John Hippisley. Governor John Hippisley was governor of the Gold Coast Castle, of the Cape Coast Castle. And he described the trade as such. The extensive employment of our shipping in and from America, the great brood of seamen consequent thereon, and the daily bread of the most considerable part of our British manufacturing are owing primarily to the labor of Negroes. The Negro trade and the natural consequences resulting from it may justly be esteemed an inestimable fund of wealth and manual power to this nation. He continued, Africa not only can continue supplying the West Indies in the quantities of slaves she has hitherto, but if necessity required it, it could spend thousands, nay millions more, and go on doing this to the end of time. Now, you begin to wonder, how is it possible that such a system could develop at all? And how is it possible that such a system could get to the extent that it did? In an abstract of evidence which was delivered before the Select Committee of the House of Commons in 1790, it says, because they were beginning to get worried about what they thought was the criminality of their commercial transactions, so the Negroes are obtained often by war and seldom by kidnapping. That is lying in wait in the village. Those who were sold in places like Gorée in Senegal were sold in a system which was called the Grand Pillage. They organized themselves. They bribe the chiefs, they attack villages, and just grab them and then take them away. The Africans, of course, resisted because there was the impression which was given that Africans willingly and happily sold their kith and kin. Research proves otherwise. There was a letter dated 31st January 1687. With your permission, I'll quote because it gives a certain impression of how the trade was carried on. Now, the factor, that is the agent of the Dutch company who was in Elmina, was writing to his bosses in Rotterdam. And he says, on the 26th December 1687, the Portugal ship Humber arrived, which I have dispatched today. If 525 pieces of slaves, there were pieces of slaves, 306 men and 139 women. Then he continues, as before, there is an abundance of slaves here, but there's also great famine, with the result that I have not been able to supply this ship with a diet. The Negroes, who as I've maintained here are not at all polite, have torn up the noble company's flag. It happens that if you want to trade on the coast, you have to pitch your flag to show that you have authority and jurisdiction. But some of our founding brothers found this annoying, and one of them came and tore up the flag. Now, the Dutch were very unhappy about this, because according to them, this event is a serious matter, and their competitors, the French and the English, were happy that our presence here is no longer brute. Then he continues, I have therefore, at my own cost, prosecuted and eradicated the flag violator on behalf of H.E. the general, just the general in the castle in Cape Coast, and I sent the flag violator by canoe to Amina. The general has publicly sentenced him to death and decapitated him, and has sent the severed head on board the company ship Good Tiger as an example of the punishment for such wantonness. I've put it here on top of the pole at the lodge. This was a typical reaction to any attempt at resisting somebody coming to your country and trying to enslave you. Now, as if this was not enough, the experience in the Middle Passage, that is, in the transatlantic crossing, was also not exactly uneventful. There is this letter again, dated 29th September 1730, in which one of the factors describes an incident. He says, in the night of the 26th, 27th September 1730, at about 1 o'clock, a heavy fire broke out near the company's lodge. As a result of a strong wind, which came dangerously close, and I did my utmost to save the company's goods and extinguish the fire as I could. But when the fire reached the powder house, because they used to keep gunpowder in the lodge to protect themselves, when the fire reached the powder house, it exploded immediately. It was as if fire had rained from the sky. Within a few moments, the entire lodge caught fire on all sides, and I just managed to save myself with the captain, the assistant, and the master. I had already boarded 145 slaves for the ship Watwin, of whom I had embarked 90 in the day before the fire. They have been embarked, that is, they have been tied up, waiting to be exported. As yet, I cannot give your highness any precise information about what happened to the others, but I know that many of them were miserably burnt alive, and others who managed to escape, we are feeding somewhere. And he goes on to say, most of the company's goods are quite safe. The truth was that the company's goods were saved, the slaves were left on their own, they had been tied up, so almost all of them got burnt. This is the kind of savagery that accompanied this trait. And Williams again describes the crossing. He says that the space allotted to each slave on the Atlantic crossing measured 5.5 feet in length by 60 inches in breadth. The slaves were packed like rows of books on shelves, chained 2 by 2, right leg and left leg, right hand and left hand. Each slave had less room than a man in a coffin. Now, according to John Newton, this is a former slave captain who had an epiphanic experience and became a born-again Christian and actually wrote Amazing Grace. He says the slaves were so cramped for want of room that for most part, both hands and feet, the two together, makes it difficult for them to turn or move, to either attempt to rise or lie down without hurting themselves. that because we're so cramped, in all the slave quarters, they had 3 or 4 large buckets of conical form that if the slaves needed to ease themselves, they could use the buckets. But they were so chained that one may doze off and wake up to find that your partner you have been tied up with is dead. But because you have been tied with him, you still have to carry him wherever you're going, even when you have to ease yourself. That the some of the slaves, because of the difficulty of just moving around to attend the call of nature, just ease themselves wherever they were. And according to James Walvin, to the laboratory buckets overflowing and slaves defecating where they lay, the slave quarters were quickly reduced to a stable-like partner. And even the surgeons on the slave ships could not bear to go to where the slaves were. The deck, that is the floor of their rooms, was so covered with blood and mucus which proceeded from them that it resembled a slaughterhouse. He concluded that it is not in the power of human imagination to picture to oneself a situation more dreadful and disgusting. In conditions like this, revolts are likely. But revolts, when they do occur, are so violently put down. But in spite of this violence, sometimes the slaves prefer to jump into the sea, and when they land in the water, they utter cries of freedom because they believe that even though they die, their souls were going back to Africa, their home. It was said that in this period, sharks became conscious of slave ships because they were sure that sooner or later somebody is going to jump to the sea, it's going to be thrown up, and there'll be a free lunch or a free dinner. So it was not unusual to find sharks always following a slave ship. They also had to ensure that now that you have a group of people who are trying every moment with every energy of theirs to escape, no matter what the dangers were, you also have to be on your guard and make sure that you stamp out any notions of liberty. So understand that there was a time when William Sledgrave, one of the British slave traders who also wrote about the profession, had occasion to crush a slave rebellion. He decided to interrogate the leaders of the rebellion why they were indulging in an act like that. And he was surprised by the answer the leader gave. He said that it was their duty to try to escape because he, Snagrid, was a great rogue to try to carry them away from their own country. So Snagrid became some kind of a consultant on putting down slave rebellions. And he stated that in such a situation, you have to identify the slaves who are most indifferent to their liberty and give them preferential treatment so that they report on their colleagues, the old theory of divide and rule. But if any of them should try to escape or to try to break away, brutal intimidation was the best course of action. Jean Barbeau, another French slave trader, wrote that if a rebellion occurs, the captain, quote, should spare no effort to repress the insolence. And as an example to the others, must sacrifice the lives of the most mutinous. He said this would terrify the others and keep them obedient. The way of making it clear to them, and I mean the punishment that most scares the Africans, is cutting up a live man with an axe
and handing out the pieces to the others. This was how brutal the business was. So, in 1721, when Snelgrim's ship was on the road from the British fort at Anomabo, there was a failed rebellion in which a white sailor was killed. Snelgrim informed the captains of the 8 other ships also on the coast of Anomabo that he was about to execute a rebel leader and that they should bring all their slaves to the decks to watch. The idea is to make the African states recognize the total impotence and uselessness of trying to resist. So he tried to make an example of the slaves who are trying to rebel. He said, with his own captives and those from the 8 surrounding ships looking on, Snelgrim's men tied a rope around the leader and hauled him up the foreyard aft. After the execution, the sailors lowered the man's body to the deck. In front of all the horrified onlookers, they cut off his head and threw it into the shark-infested sea. You know why this was done? He said this was done in accordance with the theory which was carried among slave captains, which held that the Africans in that region, the Fantis, believed that any dismemberment prevented the spirit of the person from returning home after death. So you have to terrify them so much that you banish any thoughts of resistance. This is how they came to conquer and dominate Africa. Violence. Now, he also had advice for other slave captains. He said, an incident occurred on an English slave ship commanded by Captain John Hardy. Believing that the slaves on board the ship were plotting a revolt, he ordered the arrest of the man who he believed to be the ringleader. In front of the other captives, the man's throat was slit and his heart and liver were cut out. Captain Hardy then ordered the bloody heart and liver to be cut into 300 pieces, and he forced each of the captives to eat the piece by threatening to do the same thing to them if they refused. The experience so traumatized and disgusted the captives that many of them refused all food after that, and some gradually starved to death. So who supported the slave trade? In England, all the privileged classes supported it. They accompanied the Royal Company of Adventurers trade to Africa, which was set up in 1667, had royalty, aldermen, dukes, earls, and lords as members. The church, the Anglican church, also supported the slave trade. The Spaniards saw it as an opportunity to convert the heathens, while the Jesuits and the Franciscan monks were heavily involved in sugar cultivation. Now, you cannot be involved in sugar cultivation at that time without taking part in the slave trade. Now, how was the business organized? They had something called the Asiento contract. Because Spain was dependent on foreigners for slaves, they gave contracts to people who had the money and the courage to undertake this dangerous business of slavery. 40,000 Negroes were introduced into Guadeloupe when, in the Spanish War of Secession, the British captured Cuba. Britain became the foremost slave trading country in the world, and the privilege was conceded to England by the Treaty of Utrecht as a result of the War of Spanish Secession. And they they now were controlling the Asiento contract. Now, I came across one of those contracts, very intricate contract drafted by solicitors in Guildhall. This particular contract is contract for blacks or Negroes, made and agreed with the Majesty of Great Britain for herself and such of her subjects as she shall appoint to be contractors. This was in 1701. It was between the Queen of England and the King of Spain. Let me bore you a little by reading out the actual terms. It says, with license from His Catholic Majesty, the contractor takes upon them the Asiento agreement to import Negro slaves into the Spanish West Indies and to establish this necessary trade for the mutual and reciprocal benefit of their majesties and the subjects of both crowns, and the contractors oblige themselves to import in the space of 10 years to commence on blah blah day 40,000 Negroes of both sexes and of all ages at the rate of 4,800 in each of the said 10 years. They shall be paid for all the duties, because this was trade, so you have to pay duties. They have to pay duties of 33.5 pieces of gold of the value of 4 shillings and 6 pence of English money for each slave. Now, the law, in addition to this, was also used as an instrument to make sure that the trade went on. The nature of the slave trade being so violent, it could only be perpetrated through violence, fraud, rape, and murder. In 1764, a particular legislation was passed by the Parliament of Bermuda. The title of this legislation is an act for the better government of Negroes, mulattoes, and Indians born and free, for the more effectual punishing conspiracies and insurrections of them. Now, the preamble says, whereas it is absolutely necessary that effectual provision should be made for the better ordering of governing of slaves in directing and punishing their secret plots and dangerous combinations, be it enacted by Your Majesty that if any Negro, Indian, mulatto, whether born or free, not descended from a white woman, shall be convicted of maliciously striking any white person, he or she shall either be banished from these islands or have both his or her ears cut off in like manner as here before mentioned. Where any such Negro, mulatto of India, shall be found upon proof made to have given a false testimony on any trial for a capital crime, every such offender shall without further trial be ordered by the said court or such other court before which shall at any time hereafter be proved that such false testimony was given to have 1 year nailed to a post or tree, and to have to stand for the space of an hour, and then the said ear be cut off, and thereafter the other ear in like manner be cut off at the expiration of the other half hour. This is how savage English law developed to be able to maintain law and order and discipline among slaves. But perhaps the case which was most chilling and may have helped in turning the tide for people to begin talking about abolition seriously was between one Gregson against Gilbert, 1781, known as the Zong. I'm sure a few of you must have heard about the Zong case. He said the Zong was a slave ship owned by a Liverpool trading company. It was employed in the Liverpool to West Africa route, and then with the cargo of slaves to the Caribbean. On 6 September 1781, the Zong sailed from West Africa. We are not told whether it was from Takoradi or but it was from West Africa, with a cargo of 170 slaves from Cape Coast to Jamaica. 12 weeks into the voyage, the Zong had already lost more than 60 Africans and 7 of his 70-man crew. This was a high level of mortality, even for a slave ship. So, in casting about for what to do, the slave captain, a gentleman called Collingwood, called his officers together on 29th November and put the question to them, what shall we do with these slaves? They debated it and came to the conclusion that the 6 slaves should be thrown overboard, both to secure the dwindling supplies of water and also to allow the shipping company to claim their loss as insurance. You know, insurance laws of that time was such that the insurer takes upon himself the risk of the loss, capture, and death of the slaves. But any other unavoidable incident, but natural death is always understood to be accepted. And by natural death is meant not only when it happens by disease or sickness, but also when the captive destroys himself through despair, which often happens when the slaves are killed or thrown into the sea in order to quell an insurrection. Now, when the Zong arrived in Jamaica, there was still water on board, and this matter could not have come to any notice. Except that, like any good insurer, Luke Collingwood and his insurers refused to pay. So this matter came before the court in Guildhall. Now, Gregson, the ship owners, claimed for the loss of their slaves 30 pounds each from the writer's gripping. The latter refused to pay, and thus the case became a simple matter of maritime insurance. At the initial trial, the jury sided with the ship owners, ordering the insurance company to pay compensation for the dead slaves. The slave owners, claiming the insurance on the slaves, were represented by the Solicitor General. Now, the Solicitor General argued that it was madness to try to bring a criminal prosecution for slaves who had been killed, because the slaves were property. He said, how can you claim compensation when property has been destroyed? It was like the judge who sat on the case was confused by this event, and that was Chief Justice Manfield. So in his deliberations, he said there is no doubt, and it shocks one very much, that the case of the slaves, about the case of the slaves. But in law, according to English law, it was as if horses had been thrown overboard. The slaves were chattel. This shocked the English conscience so much that the matter now came to the House of Commons, and the whole business was debated within the House of Commons. Now, some parts of Great Britain had more interest in the slave trade than others. Liverpool, for instance, was a fishing village. And they thought that any abrogation of the slave trade would be a diminution in their fortunes. However, the Secretary of State had been so moved that he thought that the British as a nation needed to atone for their committed wrongs, and that to deal and traffic in human flesh and blood, not the labor of men, was to devour the root instead of enjoying the fruits of human diligence. Opposing this motion was the MP for Liverpool, General Talley, who said that those in Liverpool, we can ill afford to adopt any measure that will create a diminution in our revenue. I have no difficulty in saying that the prosperity of Liverpool is intimately connected with the African slave trade. It is difficult for me to assent to any measure which appears to be injurious to the interests of our constituents. As the situation in Liverpool, I have this to say, it was once a mere fishing village, but it has risen into prosperity in exact proportion to the extent of African slave trade. So there were various interests at heart. At the end of that debate in the House of Commons, the British nation decided that they were going to abolish the trade in slaves. And not only that, they were going to actively engage in effecting the abolition. So the British now changed from being the poacher to the gamekeeper. And this is a story that we are presented with up to time. The British decided to present to the world that they were the most humanitarian of all the nations, even though some of their competitors were still trying to engage in the day they began the abolition. So we have to give credit to them. After abolition came the partition, and with it came the struggles for emancipation in the United States, in the Caribbean, all culminating, and I'm trying to put things in, I'm trying to make it short here, all culminating in the independence of Ghana, because our former president has stayed in the United States and has seen the US under depression. He has seen a continental nation. He has seen the vibrancy of that continental nation. He decided to adopt that. You know, he was so infected by the experience of the United States that he tried to establish the United States of Africa with Ghana as a base. We know the story of Kwame Nkrumah and how his overthrow truncated Ghana's development. I would like to end here because the later part of the story, we all know the development of the Coalition of African Unity is transformation of the African Union. What we are trying to do now is to inspire our youth to learn more about this history, because this history is so valuable to understanding of the politics of today. When you hear issues of whether Black Lives Matter or not, or whether Africa is responsible for its situation or not, we have to ensure that we engage in this discussion with the background of the history behind it. I'd like to end here. I'd like to thank you for your kind and polite attention, and I'll be ready to engage in a give and take discussion on this matter.
So we're going to open it up, as was said, for questions, question and answer period. Very sobering for those who even may know the history to get the details. That was a presentation in HD. He said he didn't have slides, but you could visualize everything that he said clear as day. So for anyone who has any questions or has anything to add, we'll take a round of three questions. And then we'll give him time to answer, and then if we have time, we'll go to another round of three questions. So now we'll come around with the microphone, so please raise your hands if you have any questions.
First of all, I appreciate your presentation. I thought it was very clear about what took place. One area that I thought was a little foggy, I wish you could just expound on it. We see the European, the British, the European involvement and what they did to persuade. But the only thing I heard clear about Africans enslaving Africans was that it was a product of war. They created wars and then enslaved them. But it's hard for me to fathom that much war when millions of Africans were taken. So I need for you to go into a little bit more detail on how Africans got from the interior to the slave ships. I can't imagine that much war going on. So I just need that to be a little clearer.
Thank you.